listening to the AfterBuzz TV Network, now the largest new media platform on the web and your number one source for after-show entertainment.
Very good, Johnson.
From the AfterBuzz Studios in Los Angeles, California, presented by Maria Menounos and Bing.com, and streaming live thanks to Akamai Technologies, this is AfterBuzz TV's House of Cards After Show. We'll break down tonight's episode and get you all the latest news and gossip. And now, another post-game wrap-up show for your favorite TV show. It's AfterBuzz TV's House of Cards After Show.
Good afternoon, good morning, good evening, After Buzzers. Bing is for doing, and today we were doing Netflix original series House of Cards, Chapter 9. I'm your host, Thaddeus Massey, and joining me are two beautiful ladies and a gentleman.
They're really classing up the joint, I tell you.
Yeah, they are. Introduce yourselves, please.
Hi, guys. Emma Kostandyan.
Hi, Sofia Stanley.
And I'm John Comerford.
So, this episode... Oh my gosh, Frank is taking hits left and right, this guy. Not to say that they're not deserving or he's not bringing these situations upon himself, which it seems to be. So many different, I'm sure you guys are definitely going to weigh in on it. But yeah, Frank, poor Francis. I mean, I want to call him Francis now. I can't even call him Frank.
Zoe
calls him Francis. She's in a very strange space because she is like, somewhat empowered and vulnerable at the same time. I think she's been elevated to a level of the competition, so to speak, she's becoming a peer almost. Whereas she wasn't really so much.
Well, she's trying to be, certainly.
She's trying to be adult
about everything.
Well, now because the stakes are thickening. So Frank has to contain Remy. And Remy is really, I think this is the first episode we've seen that we could actually start looking at Remy like has his status been elevated above Frank's?
Well, the way they shot it, they were on equal footing. I mean, if you remember the way they shot it, they were both sitting down. Far apart from each other, equal stature, equal level. Even when they were leaving, they were on the same level.
Right. So that situation is really. It's interesting. It's interesting to see how they're changing the perspective of the audience on Remy and his relationship to
also,
the situation.
Also, too, and this one I can't take credit from. This one I actually could have read either on YouTube, on iTunes, or on Twitter, so I'm not quite sure where.
Mm-hmm.
But if Frank had something on Remy, he would have used it already.
Yeah, you would think so.
Or he would have at least alluded to it to Remy.
Mm-hmm.
The only thing he can ever bring up to Remy is that you used to work for me.
Right.
Okay, so big deal, right? Sancor is your only client, and that's who you're in bed with.
Mm-hmm.
Again, so big what?
Deal. Exactly. Right.
So I think that this episode, specifically for the reason that John said, the way that the episode was shot, and, I mean, even just when Frank, during the Bill meeting, says, so how many of you got calls from Remy? Every single person raised their hand.
Right.
He's doing his homework,
as well as the fact that when they have the dialogue, and basically, you know, Frank is like, okay, well, you need me because you need the Democrats to be in power. Remy didn't even bat. He's like, we'll adapt. Yeah. Like that to me, and I can't think of the correct word, that was a little bit desperation on Frank's side.
Right.
If Frank has to use his party as leverage and not Frank,
right,
that's not necessarily a good thing.
He's reaching.
Exactly.
Well, and even in that conversation, everything he was trying, Remy had a counter for. So he was desperate. But, okay, the last thing is the last card I'm going to play, speaking of House of Cards. You do better with the Democrats than you do with the Republicans. And again, Remy just takes that away. Got a counter argument for that too.
Yeah,
Remy just doesn't need him.
But I think up until this point, him and Claire have had a united front against Remy. But we see Claire breaking that. So I think he is going to be in desperation when it comes to dealing with Remy now.
Claire.
Did anybody see that coming? I honestly didn't. I didn't see her actually going to that length.
And I think I mentioned
when did you see it, though? Because I mean, obviously, I
actually
saw it in this
mentioned
episode,
a couple of episodes ago where I said she's going to start being selfish and looking out for her own self-interest.
Yes, she did.
I think
I just didn't think she would go so far against what the quote their plans were or what Frank wanted.
And the only reason that I thought she was going to go back to Remy is that she has made subtle and not subtle references to how important CWI is to her. Mm-hmm. And I think that specifically because Frank didn't get elected to Secretary of State, that was what their goal was.
Sure.
What's their new goal? So I think that she almost from a sense of survival has to start to think about herself.
Right.
And so I think that the CWI, and as we've, you know, I think become more and more aware, she didn't fire them lightly. I definitely will eat crow on that. I thought that initially when she fired half of her staff, she just fired half of her staff because that's what she needed to do. And I didn't think she was emotionally connected to it. But with each increasing episode, the emotion with which she speaks about firing her staff, I think it really resonates with her, especially when in her mind, a corporation that they've always been in bed with. The corporation didn't mess up.
Right.
They did.
Right. Yeah.
So they're not the enemy. Just because now Frank has changed the game plan, Sancor and Remy have always done what they're supposed to do. And to me, on some levels, that's what Claire's always been, I think, attracted to.
Yeah,
that's why she's attracted to Frank.
But resonates with her as somebody following through.
Exactly.
Yeah, I think so. But, I'm going to still hold out saying that I don't think it had affected Claire emotionally as much to fire all those people, just because I don't think she's... I just don't think she has that depth. I think she I think she used it in the argument with Frank to use as a leverage point to say, look, I fired my whole staff for crying out. Half my staff, and, you know... But I don't know that it actually reached her. Because what has reached her so far? What has actually gotten to her? I don't know.
Well, here's the thing with Claire. I believe Claire does have conscience. And I believe she has been sort of a moral compass based on the things that have happened to her episode to episode.
What moral compass? I mean, I have to ask. I mean, I'm sure you have. But
I just mean as far as her being somewhat of a conscience. Like, the certain things that have happened. Like, there's always something that happens with Claire. Like, her seeing the kids in the cemetery, or... her seeing someone of her generation
working
at the coffee.
I see her somebody struggling to find a conscience, not necessarily.
No, I believe she has one, but I believe that it's important for her to know that it's working towards the greater good. So the fact that she even used that in the argument with Frank, like, look, I fired half of my staff.
Yeah.
And it turned out the results didn't turn out to be for the greater good, because they didn't, they didn't follow. What happened, she didn't get the results that they were looking for. So now...
Do you think if she had gotten the results you wanted, do you think she'd even care that you fired him?
I don't think so.
I have to talk out of the other side of my mouth, but I'm like, I don't think
It was for the greater. It would have been for the greater good,
right.
For the agenda and whatever their ultimate
goal. So the ends would justify the means.
Exactly.
For her.
Gotcha. So if that's not happening, then next thing you know, I just look like a moral
and
piece of you
for
know what
nothing?
For nothing.
But I can't necessarily answer the moral question, but I think that she has more emotion than we give her credit. And I think that the reason being is to me, this show is extremely intelligent, and in so being, it's extremely deliberate.
Right.
There would have been absolutely no reason to have the kids, you know, Russo's kids in the opening scene running around like little kids do. Mm-hmm. To me, they were a little bit out of line when they ran into Frank, and you know what I mean? Like, to me, part of me is like, okay, can't they just have been sitting there with their video games? But I'm digressing. Yeah. But the fact of the matter that Frank, you know, specifically says to the camera, you know, I can't tell a lie. I despise kids. There, I said it. Exactly. And then the next scene is Claire offering to take the children to school.
Yeah.
Right?
That
and
was
even the way that everyone turned, kind of like, huh?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, everyone seemed surprised. And yes, she wasn't quote unquote warm and gushy, but for Claire, she was. Like, the kids were opening up to her. You know, they made her little origami, what, a frog and a scorpion.
Yeah, which is interesting.
Well, go ahead.
No, the axiom or whatever, the frog and the scorpion.
Yeah.
So that was scorpion. Funny. Yeah, I thought that was interesting.
But it was.
It took me a while. I didn't catch it at first. Yeah. Thank you.
As she you know, offers to take the kids to school, she takes the kids to school. I also liked how the little girl, Russo's daughter, is so aware.
Yeah.
She is so completely aware of...
It's good casting, because she even looks like Russo.
She looks just like him.
Amazing?
It's crazy.
Yeah.
It's like, they did a really good job casting her in that role. But the awareness that she has, I think also has to give tribute to the children are way more conscious.
They're more aware.
We give them credit for. I mean, you can even think back to the things that you absorbed when you were a kid that your parents were probably like, oh, they're just 8, 9, 10, 11 years old. Mm-hmm. They don't know. But kids know. They know what's going on. They pay attention. And that's something that Russo was actually sensitive to, because he didn't want his kids involved in the campaign. He knows how smart his kids are.
Yeah.
Because I think he's pretty in touch with them when he does spend time with them, especially his daughter, because she's the cynical one, right?
You know, I'm just going to chime in here about this, the poor, the younger boy. I don't remember his name, but the Russo's youngest kid, the boy.
Mm-hmm.
He was able to look up crack baby. I mean, I just went, oh man, that you just shouldn't have to do that when you're
I don't look like that. Like
the poor kid.
Right. Don't you have parental controls at home?
Exactly. I just felt really bad for
that.
That would be a hard control. Just like really think about it.
That's true, yo. How do you do that?
Going back to Claire and what you were saying about, you know, her and being in touch, I think she's just never had the opportunities to have these feelings come out. And now these opportunities are presenting themselves, and she, you know, she doesn't really know how to deal with them. When the kids are asking her the questions or telling her, you know, what's going on at school, she's never been in that role. She's never had a, you know, a mother role. So, and we don't even know about her parents.
So I'm curious about that, because, you know, we haven't seen her be motherly in any sense or of the way.
She was definitely excited taking them.
Yeah, she was. And I don't know how much. Go ahead. Yeah. Sorry, Emma.
No, I'm just saying, I think she does have emotion, but we've just never seen
it. We don't get to see a lot.
Because even like with the homeless guy, her giving him money, just being in the class, you know, the class level that she is, money means everything. So in her mind, she might be thinking that she's actually helping him out, but it came out wrong. So I do think that she does have emotion, and she is in touch with her emotions. It's just coming out incorrectly when she's trying to act on it.
Well, she can certainly have emotions with Adam. Certainly, that's the only place she seems to be vulnerable.
And this episode, I actually realized that maybe Frank is the one that keeps on pushing her, you know, to Adam. I don't know how many of these tantrums he's thrown.
Okay, so let me pose this to everybody, because we have obviously the homeless person throwing the origami dollar bill, and then she gets, and then she's doing her own origami. Then of course she gives us the Russo's kids. Russo's kids return it, but and it's a scorpion and a frog. Scorpion, the frog. The adage is you can't change your nature. And so her nature certainly hasn't been maternal. Is that what that's about? What do you think that's about for her?
Go ahead, Thaddeus.
I think there's a couple of dynamics going on with her. I mean, we saw in the episode when they had their friends over and they were going to hit them up for money for the fundraiser or whatnot, that she, I guess, it would appear to be some kind of hot flash or something like that. Yeah. And you see that it's like she's missed that.
Yeah.
It's like
motherhood's over. Never going to happen.
And the realization of what she has sacrificed is happening for her. So there's so much that's going on with her emotionally, the dynamic. It's like, look, Frank, Francis, get your you-know-what together.
Right.
Because I've given up this, 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 and this. And specifically one of the most important things that is to females, I guess, is motherhood and family, which is symbolic. Mm-hmm. So if she's given that up and he's not following through on what he's supposed to, the stakes are so high for her. Right. It's like, look, if we don't achieve everything we're supposed to achieve and we never had a family and never we don't have that family or that comfort, security of a real home, not just two cold people who are on some political trail, then what are we truly leaving behind?
Exactly, because her legacy is CWI. Whatever goals they achieve because of that, or in lieu of, or in, I guess, in pursuit of that, I should say, because that's her only. There are no kids. So what else is there but what I achieve in this life right now?
And what's really interesting, also, or really funny, is how she went to go visit Catherine Durant. Okay.
Yes.
This meeting with Catherine that she set up to go get this $200,000 plus worth of water. Supply equipment from South Sudan or whatever.
Yeah.
And of course they're having foreign relations issues with the Sudanese and they're cutting off ties and blah, 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 blah. And there's this reason and that reason. And Catherine doesn't give her a pot to pee in just as far as the situation is concerned. So now she's turning back to Frank and is like, didn't we put her there? Like,
yeah, I know. What was the point of it?
What's going on? So as much as part of me is like, no, Claire, don't sabotage this situation with Abrams and Vandenberg to get these votes for the watershed bill. I kind of feel like she's entitled to do such. I feel like she's been left in the dark to a certain degree, and she has to take the bull by the horns. I don't know if she's necessarily doing it the right way. I can't. But at the same
you
time,
can't fault her for why she wants to do it. But I can't fault her for why.
And I'm not saying that her methods are wrong either. Well. It seems to me that there might be a better method, but seeming that there's been a break in communication with her and Frank, and how Frank has gone about doing everything he's doing, she's in right to feel vulnerable.
Yeah, but don't you think a better way is, hey Frank, look, if you don't. If we don't deal with this issue, I got to go to Remy because that's the only option I have. I would have done that. I would have just come right out and said, hey.
I think that's where she was going. But if you think about it, this is the first time that we have seen Frank be completely disrespectful to his wife. Yeah. Even just her question, like, didn't we put her there, was a very legitimate question and very in line with the dynamic of their relationship. His answer to me was juvenile and naive. He was like, well, it's foreign policy, and if she can't do anything, I can't do anything. I thought she was going to basically be like, aren't you Francis J? Is it F, J or L? Francis J. Underwood? Yeah. Do you know what I mean? Like, so you think that just because the Secretary of State, who you put in power, who's one of your pawns, says no, that means you can't do anything either?
Yeah, like, aren't any other options.
I think he's just, you know, saving up his lifelines to use for himself. For he's being selfish. He's isolated her, and it's all about him now.
I don't know when
I don't
it has
agree.
It.
So
I don't
necessarily agree with that. I don't necessarily agree that it's all about him. I believe that he does love his wife, and he does, and they are doing it together. I believe he's just gotten off track.
Oh, and I disagree. I disagree, and I think it's very important to separate two things: loving someone and being selfish. Can theoretically exist in the same space.
Okay.
So I have no question that he loves Claire.
Yes.
But it's selfish completely, because even in essence, what he does is he throws an adult tantrum.
Yeah. I mean,
do you know what I mean? Yeah. He gets completely flustered. He throws his bowl. He's yelling and screaming at her. And even notice how calmly she sits down, and even the way that she angles her body is a little bit eerie, right? Because almost the angrier he gets, her reaction is to get calm, and all I kept thinking is, oh, she's going to screw him over. Like, that's all I kept seeing, because she was too calm. She basically was like, instead of saying, like, I think another relationship, like, you lost your mind, don't yell at me like that, blah, 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 blah. The calmness, she has to react, because if they're equals, every action has an equal opposite reaction, right?
Correct.
And I think that's exactly what she did. And even that's even why she threw in the line, you just don't want to come hat in hand to someone who used to work for you.
Right.
But at the end of the day, like, get over that. Because Sancor, we've seen Sancor again and again and again. Without Sancor, they're absolutely nothing. So why are we going head to head with them?
Right.
Because there's a high price.
But plus, I think he's gone off track, and I think she does realize that I think it has to do with Zoe. I think Zoe has completely messed up his brain and his mind and the way he thinks, and she does realize that. I think Claire does realize that. It's just she's not saying anything about it. But even, you know, him lying about going to see Zoe to get the last, you know, vote or what he said.
No, this line.
Like,
does anyone have a line? This line is
great. He said,
I need to, there's one last vote
to whip. And it's like, why? I thought you guys were honest. You guys tell each other everything, so why lie about where you're going?
But, I mean, it was even earlier than that, because even after the tantrum, when he's playing video games, you know what I mean, after Zoe breaks up with him, you know what I mean, and she's like, are you okay? How's your hand? And he's just completely dismissing her, and was the first time that when he said, oh, I love you, I felt like it was a throwaway. I didn't feel like it was fake, throwaway, right?
Yeah.
It was like condescending. It was like, oh, love you, dear. And it was like, wait, they don't have that type of relationship. Like, don't do that.
It was like he was managing her.
Exactly. And thank you. Well said.
And that's not the kind of relationship they have. They're supposed to be the team doing everything together. That is evident of he's jumped on the Frank Island and doing Frank as opposed to Frank and Claire doing the Underwoods together.
Yeah.
So, and Zoe is evidence of that as well. He should have never gotten sexual with this girl. I mean, even though he wants to explain later, relating sex to power and blah, 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 which we'll talk about later. He's in a juvenile state of mind right now. And, you know, him getting dumped, and then now he's lashing out at Zoe because she's making adult decisions and wants to be professional.
This is what professional
really
feels
like. You are being such a high school bratty kid right now.
Completely.
It's ridiculous. Like, let use her for what she's good for. She's told you that I'm going to be here and available to you in the same capacity, but we don't need to do this whole thing.
How often does that work? How often does it work to come back from that?
Well, you know what's funny about the situation? I mean, he did call Zoe on hers and was you're the one that initiated this thing. I wasn't looking for that, which is true.
Yep. Everything he said was true.
Everything he said was true.
Except for the part that he being adult about it.
Right. Exactly. So,
and also too, not only that, I mean, I think that the facts of what he said to Zoe are true, but there was still way too much emotion in it. So even the fact that he had the audacity to basically be like, oh, but like you always get what you want, or you're always, is completely diminishing the fact that, oh, so you think she didn't only dangle the carrot for power as well?
Right.
Like the fact that for even for 4 minutes, he thought that she was sexually attracted to him, separate from the position that he wielded and the information that she gives him, that I was like, for me, Frank went down a notch. Because I think that the entire dynamic of what's going on here isn't simply about power, it's how he relates sex and power. So if we think about him in the way, and this is more like how I think he sees himself, not how I see him, but he sees himself as a very virile man who's always in control and always the lead general.
Right.
He hasn't been fulfilling that role.
Right.
So he's been feeling emasculated, right? So then he needs to go to the other source of power, which is sex, right? So the way he does this, and I mean this to not be disrespectful, but he does this by sleeping with a 24-year-old.
Okay, I missed the point. Yeah,
okay, so my point is, no, but my point is, well, I'm just going to be adult for a second, so any little kid, any little kids, well, I'm just going to make a guess, right? So any little kids who are watching, I apologize, but you're a grown man. No, seriously, you're a grown man. He must be at least between 55 and 65 years old, right? Yeah. So therefore, he has had decades of sexual experience,
right?
So you are going to prove your sexual prowess to someone who is just a couple years shy of being a child.
Right.
Get over yourself.
Right. Yeah, I agree, but it happens all the time.
I agree, but that's but for me, it lost something for me for Frank.
Yeah, but you know,
I really thought Frank was a little bit above that.
And I didn't ever did, but I can see why you would. But I didn't. As soon as he crossed and said, "Okay, I'll sleep with her," I was like, "What? What? What?" Are you crazy? Remember we had that discussion? You and I both were skeeved like crazy.
You know, so
I think that right there was,
a thought. And thinking about how Frank and Claire are the same person, she's going through whatever she's going through as a middle-aged woman or whatever.
And he's going through his own midlife.
He's going through the same similar circumstances, especially since he has been proven not to come through on these situations.
And he didn't get the Secretary of State. So as soon as that happened,
So now his manhood is being questioned. And this is a way to
He's trying to prove himself.
To prove it to himself.
Yeah.
You know, he's
not doing a very good job of it.
He's not. But he's, you know, all these things are happening.
Yeah.
And then you got a guy like Remy who's probably 20 years younger than him.
Yeah,
maybe,
it looks like about that. Yeah.
And came up under him and is in a more powerful position that he's in. It's like, look, I decided to get away from the Republicans and the Democrats, and I can make things go either way by throwing a few checks in whatever in any direction that we want to.
That's
power.
Money.
I think
that's
very
power.
Well said.
That's extreme power that Remy has. And just like we said, talking about last
and that's just Remy. That's not even who's in charge of Remy.
Exactly.
Right.
Remy is kind of like tell them this.
Exactly. He's a messenger.
The stamper for somebody else.
But the difference is, but the fact of the matter is, even in the Bill meeting, Frank didn't say who got a call from Glendon Hill, which is the law firm. He said Remy. Who has got a call from Remy.
Yeah.
So that slight distinction does put the fact that it really is Remy wielding the power and not simply the law firm, the law firm or Sancor.
Yes.
Because they choose their words very carefully.
Yes, they do. And the fact that what happened at the hotel when Remy came, that was for the library dedication.
Mm-hmm.
When Remy came and he saw Claire in the hotel.
And either hit on her or not hit on her.
Depending on how you guys want to look at it.
I've now changed my tune.
Right. But just his swagger and how he dealt with that situation, that would even pose a bigger question to Claire as to like, okay, the ball game is really, well, the landscape weird? Has changed, yeah, she, as they used.
The way she, well, speaking to that point, because she was so, I don't know if offended is the right word at his approach. And then she goes right to him.
Because, but you know what I think it is, though? I just think that, I think it's very interesting.
Yeah, she goes to Remy.
But I think it's very interesting. But I think that part of it was, I think that ironically, think about it. After the tantrum, I think this specifically what she said is, she goes, I'm sorry, Francis, I didn't think this through. Mm-hmm. That was like bullshit line. Sorry. Right. My bad. Now I'm like crossing. Anyways, right? Sorry. And the reason being is she is just as calculated, if not more calculated, than Frank. So she thinks everything through. Right. I think in that short period of time, she really assessed and she said, oh my goodness, maybe I was still thinking about Remy as if he was on staff. Mm-hmm. And not now seeing him for the position, because I think that's, again, why it was extremely important for him to be like, I have the presidential suite. Yeah. I didn't stay there before. So even the way that he
bridal
was.
Bridal suite.
Oh, sorry. Thank you. The bridal suite. Totally different. That's very different. And then now, literally, just as Thaddeus said, not only does he wield all the power, theoretically, the role of the whip is to get his party in line. Right. Right?
Yep.
Frank wasn't able to do that off of Frank. Yeah, why? Because of Remy.
Yeah. Remy outdid him.
Remy outdid him. But Remy's has continued. Well, Remy has lost
but
yet.
But he outdid him only with his wife's help. Because if it was not for Claire, my guess is he would have had those two
But
votes.
Then I think that's why it's very important that she really symbolizes the queen.
Yeah.
She, and I think that the problem was Frank started to treat her like a pawn.
Right.
And not like a queen.
Right. He wasn't working with her. He was using her.
Well, that's what, that's the thing.
As opposed to working with her, like we were saying. But the bravado that Remy embodied when he went to that meeting with Claire, and she was like, it was almost like she was kind of using her authoritarian tone a little bit, even though it was like, okay, we'll go ahead and blah, 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 blah. The 1 point, you guys were willing to give us a 1.5. You said, well, the offer was in. You declined that. Yes, the landscape has changed since then.
Yeah.
So this is what it's going to be, and this is how it's going to go down if this is what you want. And he is pretty much, you know, he's got some, you know, Sandcorp is obviously, they're the big dogs.
Well, yeah, well, they're the ones with all the money, the deep pockets. I mean, Frank was saying that.
And, you know, and he has the relationships. So he cannot be overshadowed, overshined in this particular circle of politicians. Mm-hmm. So Claire's going to have to do what Claire's going to have to do in order for Claire to get that $200,000 plus worth of water supply equipment from the Sudan.
Now, the only thing is, the only thing is, there's two things that kind of caught me a little off guard. Why meet with him at your office? Like, somehow...
To keep it professional is my only guess.
I think that's a very good point.
Because of what happened last time.
Yeah.
Okay. And also, if you have a meet on your turf, then, you know, okay, as opposed to meeting in neutral ground, you're trying to establish a certain thing.
She was keeping it professional, but she was kind of giving in a little bit.
Well, she had to. She needs a favor.
She had to do it on her home turf.
But this is my only concern is, even though, like, I'm not saying I'm Team Claire, because I'm not really Team anybody, but when she had the final meeting with the two undecided reps, and basically she basically said to them, yeah, like, I kind of agree with you, so, you know, vote for with your conscience. Like, I think I literally did the, like, touchdown, threw my hands up. Like,
you were happy about that?
I was so happy. Wow, but then I thought, oh my God, what are you going to do now? Like, do you know what I'm trying to say? Like, what are you going to do now? Because that last line, like, who lied? Like, I literally thought, like, Frank's going to, like, kill somebody.
Well, because I went back to what Frank said, is friends make the worst enemies. But certainly couples who are no longer friendly make the worst enemies.
I mean,
they may be against each other.
She's had some run-ins with Adam, but she hasn't disrespected Frank like he's done to her. And it wasn't up until this episode that I started realizing that he's just doing it. He's just sleeping with Zoe to make himself feel important to Claire.
Yeah.
To make Claire kind of like stay on her tippy toes and want him.
Oh, you think he's trying to get Claire jealous?
Not jealous. I think he's just trying to make it seem like he's really important, that, you know, he has to do this for business.
Oh.
But I think
in a weird way, I understand your reasoning, but for the dynamic of who they are, I think that does the exact opposite. Because that's specifically why she goes, well, can you control her? Like, if you have to control her with sex, you're not actually controlling her. And that's even why Zoe says what Zoe said. Zoe basically was like, you were already controlling me. So why are we sleeping together? Because obviously, like, you're not enjoying it. And I think that even was, no, but I mean, even that was mature, though.
Yeah.
She didn't come at him like a child and say, like, oh, I'm the young one, whatever. She goes, you're not enjoying it, and I know I'm not.
Yeah, I know.
You know what I mean?
And then, thought it was incredibly frank, and I thought that was great.
And then she basically was like, oh, okay. Oh, so I'm the whore. I can play the whore, but I just want to know what my role is, so now pay me. Because even the audacity when she's like, okay, so what's their vote with Russo? And he's like, oh, don't we want to shower first? Dude, don't do that.
I'll shower after you leave.
Thank you, right? Because we know the nature of this relationship. Don't you now try to bring it in some romantic BS just because you had me call my dad.
I think that Zoe has shown an extensive amount of wisdom and savvy by becoming aware and becoming conscious that she's operating on a level that's above her experience, and she showed this by recruiting Janine to Slugline. She got Janine to Slugline. Now Janine is there. She can use Janine as a mentor because Janine's been there, done that. So now,
and was very open with her.
Janine is jaded, incredibly.
And we learned why.
But she can learn from all of Janine's mistakes without her actually telling Janine all of her business and what's going on at the same time. I mean, she's got Janine buying her Chinese food at the office.
Thai food.
Thai food. Sorry.
We're going to get letters.
It was Thai.
But green curry for me and the green curry for you.
Right.
How many of us think that it might have been Frank she was sleeping with as well?
Ooh.
I initially went there with you and then I didn't. I mean, that's initially the first thing, but then I was like, no. And you want to know why? Frank wouldn't. Oh, I'm going to so talk out of both sides of my mouth.
Okay,
Frank wouldn't be that messy knowing that it's Janine now being recruited back to Slugline.
Yeah, that was my thing. I didn't think, you know what I mean? Yeah,
yeah.
Frank
wouldn't have had his stuff so close in the same house.
But I think the writers definitely wanted you to think that possibly.
That's a possibility.
That
many of them. It could be.
There's a ton of congressmen. But, you know, she's going through a similar situation. Right. And Frank has been the man for quite a long time, and who would you be able to get those kinds of stories from?
Yeah, but she didn't get those kinds of stories, if you recall. She had
but she was getting the stories because she was sleeping. And then,
but this is a different
hit a wall with the congressman.
True, but I think that part of the reason why Janine was apprehensive or suspected something regarding Zoe, but at the same time respects her in a weird way, it's because Zoe's getting way better stories.
That's right. That's why she's sleeping with a better class.
Seriously, because I think that's even why she said, like, she feels jaded because she was like, I effed my way to the middle.
Right.
Zoe ain't in the middle because Zoe's the one, but Zoe's the one who brought her over from Slugline, despite the fact that she's a White House correspondent from the Herald.
Right. Yeah.
So I think, though, the only thing for me, and I think we've talked about this before, is that the difference between whether or not people are thinking very far in advance or whether or not they're just adapting very quickly. And I think Zoe is just like Frank and ironically just like Claire, even though I think Claire is a little bit more calculated than the rest of them.
Mm-hmm.
She's thinking on her feet as information comes to her. Right. So just that interaction with
Janine. She's exactly like Slugline. She's adapting. She's, I mean, that's what she did.
But when she's breaking up with Frank, did you see she was standing in front of the portrait?
It was a child.
Yeah, that was
so
great.
So I think in a way trying to be like, okay, you're trying to gain your independence, but you're still a child.
Mm-hmm. I despise children.
Yeah. Right, but then can I say something? But then stop.
Like,
what,
the
I agree.
Epitome
but
of evil in his eyes.
But
when
then
he said
stop
that.
Treating her like a child.
Yeah,
because you're the only child in this scenario.
Because he didn't get to break up with her,
right? Because everyone else, but technically he did. But he still was emotional about it because she goes, "I think we should break up with one another." She still technically allowed him to go, it's over. And then she goes, okay, cool. So are we still good?
Yeah, I think we should end it. And one more thing. And what's so funny about that scene was that when he stood up and he was about to leave after they talked business, and she says, I'm sorry, there's one more thing. He stood there like, yes, go ahead and apologize to me. And then she was like, and she stands up, I think we should end it. He was totally not expecting that. I was like,
And you know, the whole thing, and what did he say at the beginning? I don't want surprises.
Yes.
And it wasn't just those two guys. That's it. Claire surprised him.
Yep.
Zoe surprised him. Yep. He does not do well with the plans as one. And the other thing I wanted to point out is it's just a weird thing. Last week with the whole Father's Day and all that thing, and now this week with the, you know, don't be a child, and the, you know, it was just so I don't know, it's incestuous isn't quite the right word, but it comes close.
I completely agree with you. And I mean, even the fact that she even mentioned, she goes, if you had a daughter, she would be older than me.
Right. In 20 years, I'll still be younger than you now. That's like...
And he, but he despises children, too. It's like, well, then why are you just...
I totally agree. Well, but I think it shows his vulnerability.
Well, he likes to control. And see how the kids are just running around? Kids, I think, represent...
If you can't control,
you can't control it. Non-control, and this is part of the reason why he's
a control freak. He's a narcissist.
But he likes children because technically everyone in his life comes at him very directly. Zoe was basically very clear.
Right.
Zoe's like, as long as you give me information, I'll give you whatever you want. Right. But don't mess with that. And basically she was like, okay, cool. We don't need to sleep with each other in order to have this information where you use me for whatever you need to use me for. And he despised her for that. That he completely controlled her.
Right.
And she wasn't acting like a child. She acted very adult. Even her tone was adult. She didn't yell and scream. She basically was like, oh, so what's the deal? And he's like, your tone. And she's like, oh, so just having slept with me wasn't good enough. Now you're worried about my tone.
Yeah.
Their conversation was very adult, and I think that's why he went off the deep end, and he acted like a child and went back home and played video games.
Exactly. But for me, they were both you are, but what am I?
Exactly. That's I put that on both of them as far as that situation is concerned. Because she was really adult.
She was just, no, we're done.
Exactly. And just been like, okay, she did have a tone, she had an attitude, and it was they were both playing the game.
But I appreciate what you're saying about how he goes,
and
he's a child, he's a narcissist. He is. If he doesn't get his way, he does a tantrum, just like he's having the dish and everything. Right. He is. He's a child.
And he talks about, what does she think I'm gonna do? Sit here and twiddle my thumbs? And he's twiddling his thumbs playing a video game. I was just busted up laughing. I thought that was the funniest thing when he was saying about twiddling his thumbs and he's sitting there playing.
Yeah.
Oh, I don't know what game it was, Call of Duty or something like that. It was hilarious. Yeah. And he was letting off steam, venting. And then he jumps up like Claire a middle school kid. And he's like, I got one more whip to. I'm like, dude, really?
But when Claire comes in and he's playing the game, I swear to God, it looks like a mom and a kid.
Yeah.
I completely agree.
She like sits on the edge of the.
How was your day, dear?
Yeah.
No, I agree. Okay. But no, I mean, the funny thing is, though, it's they obviously are bringing in the video games for a reason. And video games are on some levels very relaxing. Like, I know that I just got like a new Galaxy Tab and I play like all the time.
Just a live
read. And it was funny. No, it is a live read. Don't sit up.
I'm sorry. I didn't realize. I didn't see the list.
It totally threw me off. So, I play games on my Galaxy Tab, luckily we got an email the other day from our producers at AfterBuzz, and now we are streaming live on all iDevices. So that includes iPhones, iPads, and all Android tablets, phones, smartphones, you name it. You can not only obviously watch our webisodes, you can listen to our podcast, our podcast, but more importantly, you can actually stream live. Yes. So right now, if you're on a computer, you can switch over to your iDevice.
Yeah.
So that's just one of the many things that we're doing. And there's a lot of other very cool things that AfterBuzz will be rolling out in the next couple of months. So one of the best ways that you can check that out is by going to the website, which is www.afterbuzztv.com. Or also, too, for a lot of you guys on iTunes, that is one of the best ways for you to stay in touch with us. And all you simply do is you go to iTunes.com and you type in AfterBuzz TV. And then you press in House of Cards, and it brings up our podcast, and you get to listen to us. And the best way to do that is by rating, comment, and subscribing. And again, tell a friend, because a lot of people don't know that there's an After Buzz TV House of Cards podcast. So make sure you tell a friend. So again, you just go to iTunes.com, After Buzz TV House of Cards, and you rate, comment, and subscribe.
You can also follow us on Twitter, and you can watch us on YouTube and IG, which is also known as Instagram. For you guys who don't know what IG is,
we need to get John over here.
I just want to be on social media. That's what the kids say.
Right. Next thing, you can follow me on IG.
That's right. That's right.
Okay, so let's switch gears here a little bit. Let's talk about Russo and this campaign, this gubernatorial campaign.
Hey, yeah, there you go.
That he is on, and how Vice President Matthews joins him on his campaign to help him.
It's good to see Russo out in the field. It's good to see him actually being the congressperson and this hopeful governor that we would want him to be. He was like handling himself pretty good.
And I think Christina's handling the situation. I think he needs a handler. He just he needs a Russo needs a handler. He needs structure. This guy is not the kind of guy who is obviously he doesn't have a Frank type of persona. He needs to have an itinerary. He needs to know where he's going in order to be. Mm-hmm. And when he after he got elected to Congress, he's
just over it.
Yeah, exactly. Because it's like
watching.
I'm here. Shipyard's open. Everything's great. So, you know, this is definitely a guy who always has to have an agenda and always has to have a plan in order to stay on track, or otherwise he'll be snorting lines.
That's not good. But I love the way he went at the VP. I thought that was great. Talk about being adult. Mm-hmm. I mean, this is the first time we've actually seen him really be adult.
Yeah, I mean, talking about acting juvenile. Yeah, Matthews is acting like a kid.
That was a spoiled little brat. Yeah, exactly.
What? Hungry.
Where's my pen?
Right.
Where's my pen?
Yeah. You know, I'm standing. I'm like, no, I'm fine right here. I'm gonna stand right
here.
Exactly. I'm gonna do what I want. You know, I'm the vice president.
However, there was a moment, and that's why I loved the exchange between Russo and the vice president in the vice president's hotel room. Because for that split second, I did feel sorry for him. Because even he said, he was like, I left the governor's mansion in my prime.
Yeah.
And I thought that being vice president was a step up. And he basically is like, now I'm being paraded around like some kind of mascot. Mm-hmm. And he's realizing, like we saw, you know, in the previous episode, that not only does he doesn't have any power or any leverage,
influence.
But he's a joke. Like, they don't like him. Like, they really only used him
together,
for whatever political influence Pennsylvania has, which, again, I still haven't quite figured out.
Right.
Because Pennsylvania obviously is extremely important. Like, they keep bringing it up again and again and again. And I feel like the way that Russo stood up to him was so, it was such a perfect balance. Because I think that he played on his pride and he gave him deference to the fact that you're also a fighter. I respect that. Like, I respect who you are as a man. We may not come from the same place, but we come from the same state.
Right.
But I'm gonna do this with or without you because I have the same drive and determination that you do.
Mm-hmm.
So what's up?
Right.
And we saw how quickly the vice president, he became presidential. I don't want to say vice presidential because that sounds weird.
Right.
But
no,
he stepped into a completely different role where prior he was folksy.
Right.
Like Frank said, just people want him to be folksy and tell stupid jokes and basically call his mom a hen and make fun of Pittsburgh. Like, it was disrespectful on some levels. I mean, he's charming, people laugh.
Right.
But when he introduced Russo at the end, he stepped into
glowing.
His possession and he stepped into his role. And I think it's not a coincidence that at the end, it was Linda, the vice president, and Frank all in the office. He felt included, like he had a spot at the table.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
But, you know, it's one of those things I go, really? You gave up your governorship thinking that you were going to have influence as a vice president? Who does that? Nobody. I mean, again, I just go, everybody knows vice president's where you go to die. It's politically, unless you're going to actually go for the governorship. I mean, excuse me, the presidency.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Nobody. That's why it's such a hard thing to get people to accept.
Wow.
And I was actually really impressed with
it was funny as it's counterintuitive if you think about it.
Yeah.
To think that the vice presidency would be a place where you kind of go and just.
I think it would be great. You don't have to get very little responsibility. You get to go to all the parties. It'd be awesome.
But that's why I think that you have to have someone who enjoys that seat, like possibly the current person.
Show up at the cast the deciding vote in the Senate.
He seems like he's having a good time.
Ribbon ceremony. What are we doing now? Let me pardon the Turk. Oh, I can't.
I want to address Claire's reaction to finding out that Jillian was pregnant.
Wow.
Which I think is a major point that we should discuss.
Again, we were talking about
because of the whole maternal thing.
Yeah,
and
absolutely.
Her going through what seems to be, they haven't used the M word, but they're.
But no. Frank last week said, "Why didn't you tell me?" I mean, they haven't used the word.
No,
but I think
they didn't use the word.
Oh, okay,
they
that's a good point. That's a very good point.
Yeah. Yeah. For whatever reason, I don't know why.
Yeah, it's like,
but,
I'll use it. It's not a bad word.
Right.
Menopause.
It's not.
What? Jeez, crying out loud.
Right. I'm just trying to figure out why haven't they just said it. Like,
I don't know.
But they haven't used the M word.
It's
that's
so
why I said
for
the
people
M-word,
who are so
like,
honest
so
with
like,
each other, so to speak, they can't even.
Right. So the fact that I thought it was strange, like, Claire, like, when they showed her walking away from that office.
Yeah.
Her body language and tone was
sad.
It was more than sad. There was, to me, other stuff going on.
Sure.
And I think, I feel it might have something to do with the fact that she was pregnant for a married man. And she's married. So I felt like.
You mean Jillian?
Jillian.
Okay.
Yeah, I felt like Claire had a reaction to that.
Okay.
It just felt like to me.
So it wasn't just the fact that she's having a baby and I never did. It was about,
that was one part of it. Okay. And then when she found out he's a married man, we had this thing. And then she said, no, you don't have to explain. Mm-hmm. But then there was like this reaction, like this look on her face, because she's married. And her husband's sleeping with some young girl like her.
True. I think she was walking away dissatisfied with herself because she's now thinking, I've never done anything to stop him. And what if one day he comes home and, you know, he's pregnant. He announces that he's pregnant. You know, Zoe's pregnant. What is she going to do?
Right. Well,
and we don't know, you know, how many times Clara has had an abortion. Does she ever mention that? I'm sure there has to be, you know.
I totally disagree with you on that one. Claire is such a calculated. Claire doesn't make mistakes.
So you don't think that
she'd
ever
get
pregnant?
Seriously, no, never. Yeah. Claire does not make mistakes. I think that what's telling is that I think it was either last episode or two episodes before when she's talking about Adam and Adam specifically asked her why you guys haven't had kids.
Mm-hmm.
Theoretically, she laughs at his comment like, "Oh, can you ever picture me, you know, mm-hmm. changing nappies, so forth and so on," and she says, "It's not like we ever had a discussion." Frank, obviously, in this episode, was telling that Frank says, I despise children. That's why they didn't have kids.
Sure.
Right.
We have never heard her reasoning beyond simply potentially implying that that's what Frank wanted, so she went along with it.
Right.
I keep thinking that they keep bringing, keep bringing up this kid issue again and again in a way where I'm not sure if she was 100% on board. But I just don't think
we get a little
mistakes.
Bit of hinting about it when she was in the hospital with the former guard. You kind of get an idea of where what she had pictured for her life,
mm-hmm.
which was not the familial surroundings.
True.
So it well, wasn't.
I forgot about that. Yeah.
But the other thing that I thought was interesting, because here's what I went with when Julian tells her that she's pregnant, she's walking away. Where I went with is, damn, why did I hire her? She's pregnant.
I think that was too yeah. because even though she's pregnant, I think she still expects her to do her job and to go and not take time off.
Yeah.
That's how I took it. I think because she puts her job first and she hasn't had a real. You know, she has never had the mother responsibilities.
I disagree with that. I would say that normally, if the episode was different, that's where I normally would have gone. But to me, there definitely was sadness.
Oh yeah.
For Claire, that would have been anger. It would have been a little bit more angry. And so I think that even the pace that she was walking and her posture would have been more erect. She seemed, I think, like Thaddeus said. Anyways,
you could have left it. You could have let that one. Like,
sorry,
just let it go.
You're talking about pregnancy. It just made sense. Okay, go ahead.
Right. She seemed like defeated, dejected. She seemed sad, and I think that again, I think that there is definitely something to be said about what she's going through, and just thinking about a life that could have been.
Yeah.
Because it's not a coincidence that every previous time that we've seen her and Adam, there's so much more passion.
Right.
So I think that to a certain extent, family symbolizes, it may symbolize chaos, but it symbolizes passion and a different kind of frenzied energy versus what her and Frank have. It's not like they're jet setting throughout Europe or in Bali or somewhere fabulous. Like they're in DC in a very stark house with a stark life and stark strategies that aren't going anywhere.
Okay, well, you know, to support what you've been your position on Frank's ambition towards the White House all season so far, you're like, that's not what I think that his position is. And now seeing that, you know, Frank obviously has said it point blank, he despises children. If they have such a calculated plan, what is this plan? Because I've not once seen a president who didn't have a family.
Exactly.
So that really doesn't make sense. At least adopt if you don't want to have the kids yourself. Adopt. That's because that's part of
how we view it. That's from a marketing perspective
campaign
of the president.
Exactly.
Thank you. Thank you.
So now I'm starting to think, well, maybe that's not what his ultimate goal is. What is his ultimate goal beyond Secretary of State or just Secretary of State? Because they don't have a family. And
Lord God King? I don't know. I'm not sure.
Not in that order.
No.
I think God will come first.
Yeah.
as far as he's concerned. Really quick before we wrap up, I don't want to leave this guy out because he seems to be the mind, the alter ego of Francis J. Underwood, and we know him as Stamper.
Oh, yeah.
What's going on with this guy and the Rachel situation? Why has he got this? I mean, obviously, it seems like it's gone beyond a managerial situation.
Yeah, just
for
trying
him.
To keep her under wraps.
Exactly.
It seems like he's having
feelings.
Yeah, but again, I don't, you know, it's he's already slept with her, so there's that, and he can't. How do you separate that? But I don't think he wants to have a relationship with her, like boyfriend, girlfriend, or dating or anything like that. I think it's more
uncle niece.
Yeah,
yeah,
that's exactly what I think.
Thank you.
I think it's the guilt coming back. Remember how she made him feel guilty?
Yeah,
now he kind of feels like he does need to protect her in a way. So it's not feelings like he's in love with her. It's just feelings like he cares about her.
Oh, and he certainly doesn't want anything bad to happen to her.
And I think it's also, this is going to sound weird, whenever life affects you directly, mm-hmm. it's almost like your whole world changes, right?
That's
so think
weird.
About it. So
that's so weird.
But I mean, for instance, like he has no problems, you know, with getting a prostitute, right? But the minute you know the prostitute, right? Whenever they say
they
like every
human.
Woman, right, is someone's, you know, daughter or someone's, you
sister,
know, sister,
mother,
right?
Is, yeah.
That's I think exactly what's happening. So even in the interaction with the
manager.
Thank you, with the manager, he had to basically be like, "Is that me?"
Right.
Do you know what I'm trying to say? So
yeah,
on some levels, from an outsider perspective, it's like that stuff goes on all the time. You didn't care. You put the money in her mouth.
Right.
And we're buying her off and basically was like, oh, open your mouth. And like was like, you need to do me too.
Clearly able to compartmentalize.
Yeah.
As soon as she said, I thought he says to her, I thought you weren't doing that anymore. Once she had made that decision and she know he could no longer see her as what he knew her as, he's boom. Now she's not that anymore.
Okay, well, we want you guys to let us know what you think.
You're weighing in on this.
The Stamper situation, because it's very, it seems like it's somewhat pivotal and it's going to come back into play maybe later. And that guy, whoever, I can't think of this guy's name, whoever's
Leo?
playing the role of
the manager?
Of Stamper.
Oh.
But this guy is playing
amazing.
The intensity of this actor amazingly. I love the way he's playing this role. And he goes to prove that there's no small roles, there's only small actors. Bam. Thank you very much.
Write that down.
So we're going to go ahead and wrap up. I'm Thaddeus Massey. Where can we find you guys?
You can find me on Twitter at Sofia Stanley.
You can find me on Twitter at I am Emma K and Instagram Emma_3xK.
You can find me at the IG Twitter 39.
Coming soon.
You can find me at Club Thaddeus and Club Thaddeus Twitter and IG, aka Instagram. Until Chapter 10 of Netflix's House of Cards. See you guys next time.
From Bing.com, executive producers Maria Menounos, Kevin Undergaro, Phil Svitek, and the entire AfterBuzz TV staff, we would like to thank you for listening to the AfterBuzz TV network. To watch or listen to other after shows and post comments or questions, be sure to visit AfterBuzzTV.com. I'm Sir Richard Wentworth, and this has been a presentation of AfterBuzz TV.
Buzz you later.
The views expressed herein are those of the hosts only and do not necessarily reflect the views of AfterBuzz TV or its owners or principals.